mutual visions can be made for this Vishwadhyayana. And coming to that, everything starts by history. There are two things. Anybody working without studying history, he is an idiot, because without understanding the proper mental setup as well as development setup of these people over generations and over periods, it is not easy for a person to implement something for the contemporary status. So anybody without studying coming for contemporary studies is an idiot. Anybody studying mere history, not interested in contemporary application, is a lunatic. So we must not be either. One should have a strong base of historical grounds wherever we have to learn from things. Whenever we learn about our failures, we get boosted emergence of our willpower and dynamism. If we are positive, we will shelter into revenge if we are negatively dimensionalized. So we must know about the success stories. We must know about the achievements of our ancestors. We should know about the purity. We should know about the greatness of those people. We should know about the cleavage that exists. In some places, we appear to be advanced. In some places, they appear to be more advanced than us. We have lost a lot of things. They have gained a lot of things. We are gaining a lot of things. Perhaps they may not be having the same thing which we are having now. In this mutual study of historical past as well as the contemporary present, there will be gaps, cleavages, dimensional variations and distinctions that we have to understand. And when coming into the real historical perspective, first of all, any person should not have lost the opportunity of studying the values of their heritage. It is very important. Otherwise, a strong, determined patriotism cannot be inculcated in people, those who don't know about the pride of the nation, the glory of the nation. When compared to that of things, there are a lot of things. In rewriting history, now there was a seminar about rewriting the history of India. Because history is always authored by people, those who are Eurocentric. Whenever somebody is authorizing, there are two problems. One is chauvinism, second is bias. If you author your own nation's history, then you may be very much interested in boosting it. So there will be a lot of chauvinistic reports. If it is 10,000, you will say it is 35,000. If a biased person comes, he will say 10,000, he will remove two zeros and say it is just 100 years. So it should be unbiased, it should be logistic. See, for all things we cannot get evidences. There are a lot of evidences. One is a revelation and realization evidence. It is known as paramaterial evidence, in which for each and everything we cannot see for an inscription. Inscription is an evidence, numismatics is an evidence, paleography is an evidence, archaeology is an evidence, epigraphy is an evidence, historical tradition is also an evidence. Apart from this, there is some sort of realized, proven evidence by means of assessing the mental maturity and intellectual maturity of our ancestors, which cannot be an evidence by mere archaeological inscriptions. So that type of evidence should increase the pride of our people in knowing about the nation. And whenever there is the Eurocentric invasion in making the history, there are a lot of things into. At the time of the greatest literature or the first literature that is there in record in the world, Rig Veda, when it evolved, whenever there is a literature evolving, before thousands of years at least, even if you accept the gradual accumulation theory of a linguistic development or philological development, there should have been first some sort of phonetics, some sort of acoustics, first some sort of gesticulation and sound making. It is known as the science of semichics, in which they make gesticulations, emblems, signs and symbols. The first initial way of communication that should have been matured into some way of sounds, then sounds being properly put into various things like orthography in the form of writing, then getting into etymology, terminology, orismology, semantics, syntax, grammar and various other limbs of philology. It would have taken thousands of years, even before 2500 BC, to have that origination developed. If a language development takes that much of time, then conceptive development, conceptive revelation of the Rig Veda, that would have taken thousands of years. If revealing the conceptation, see, somebody if they thinks about the concept, immediately they may not say. The concept that has been hidden, that has been modeled inside, that would have taken lot of years. Because to think about something, it is a process. To think everything with coordination is the second process. To integrate that coordination in a proper structure is the third process. To put them everything in a structure known as a grammar, that framework, is the fourth process. Then revealing them in the form of literature with a proper compilation as a company is the fifth process. Then propagation by means of a disciplinic and disciplined succession, guru parampara, that is a process. Even if we say that, that takes a lot of years, whereby we did not see any trace of civilization. Those people, they were in absolute nudity of both civilization as well as the methods of survival in the whole global communication. So the Eurocentric theory is, they were not happy to hear that, because that which is before Christianity or that which is before the civilization era of the Europe, they won't accept. Even the greatest civilizations, for example, Arab is there. Arab country, the lot of pre-Islamic religions were there which have been trampled. The only greatness of our land is it has a composite growth or a collective growth. Somebody told that there is no God. That is Sankhya school of thought. They told that there is no God. Only nature and human beings, or nature and living beings, or nature and souls. It was accepted and given a status in a land. And Kanada told that everything is by an atomic emergence. Paramanuva, that there is no God, it is accepted. Only rituals are there and there is no God. Dhirishwara Mimamsavada, it is accepted. There is God and has different forms, it is accepted. Cheshwara Mimamsavada. So, Nayayika, Vaisheshika, Sankhya, Yoga, Pasupada, Madhyamika, Sautrantika, Vaibhashika, Yogachara, Arhata, Bhata, Prabhagara, Shankara, Dvaita, Yadava, Prakasha, Dvaita, Dvaita, Advaita, Bhavadvaita, Achintya, Veda, Veda, innumerable mutually discriminate and contradictory systems evolve and collectively survive in a land. There may be some clashes, either moral clashes or criminal clashes. That is the mistake of the organization, not mistake of the natural structure of the code of conduct of our land. So there are these pre-Islamic religions having innumerable things of paganism, whereby they preserved innumerable personifications for each and every force of the land. How we can compel a person to accept only one language or one food? Likewise, different type of God, it is natural. This type of system, pre-Islamic religions, even they say that there were perishing Arabs like Ad community and Thamud community. This Ad and Thamud community, they are real Arabs and they are perishing now. Second thing is the Quaternarians of the Arabs, who are the real pure Arabs. And this Ismail tradition of the Abraham, they are known as Arabized Arabs even by the Arab history. So these people are Arabized. They entered, they dominated. See, whatever they are telling about the Aryans is really done by the Christian and Islam community. These people, they have been Arabized by means of their settlement in just 650 AD. And at that time, whatever that existed, by means of the various traditions of the world, they had innumerable things. Nassatian community. Nassatian community existed. Quaternarian community existed. Then Himyarka community, Himyarka dynasty that existed. Innumerable dynasties and innumerable personified forces of nature, like zoolatry, herbolatry, worshipping of trees and nature, everything existed there. It was totally trampled. So there, whenever a community, but there are two things. Which was the place of origination and which is a place for survival? There are two questions. Which was the place of origination? Which is the place for survival? In which everything flourished should be the place of origination. In which everybody was allowed to survive, that should be the place for survival of people. So likewise, everything flourished from our land. Innumerable thoughts. I've already told, in English we can say philosophically, substantialism, existentialism, atomism, neotheism, pantheism, metatheism, megatheism, innumerable things we can add in the form of Sanskrit, whatever I have told. So everything flourished here, it should be the origin. Everything is still surviving here, and there is a decency, lenience and proper licensing for everybody to practice their own things within a reasonable limit, without clash, without any collision. There should be contact, there should be communication, there should not be any sort of clash and collision. So that has been administered here. So it is the land of survival, it is the land where everybody originated, it is the destination land for everybody, even though they live at other lands, for any knowledge transmission, for any satisfaction, for any solace and embrace, for getting intellectual or spiritual boost, or even at the time of their tiring nature which they are going to do after a lot of technical inventions, one day they are going to fed up with technology, they have to come for a divine training, they have to come for their own rejuvenation by means of a spiritual process, and this is the land. And second thing is Iranians, Persians, they are having a very great traditional history. Even at the time of our flourishing, Iranians, they have no history at all. The greater Irania, that included Tajikistan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Iran, Iraq, various other regions, you know, even Turkey, Afghanistan, everything is included in the mega Iranian province. And there were Bags, there were Persians, and there were even great tribes like Zoroastrian civilization that existed in Persia, and even the Amlite situation. That is, there were two civilizations. One is Proto-Amlite and second is Amlite. So Proto-Amlite and Amlite civilization that existed, Zoroastrian civilization existed, they were worshippers of nature and they were very much adhering to our own civilization. And even the cradle of civilization of Rome and Greek. Rome, it started only in the 9th century BC. Then we were flourishing with Rig Veda, which has information about palaces, civil engineering technology, navigation technology, agriculture, animal husbandry, coinage, stampage, everything, all type of transmission, communication, transportation and high advanced methods of survival has been mentioned at the time of which they have been just sleeping and crawling at the cradle whenever they mentioned about some issues like Romulus and Pompilius at that time they were